And there's just no other way to do it than to set up a strategy, a guideline, a pathway, and follow that pathway.
How is it looking? Because when the U.S. pulled out of that agreement, there was a lot of hullabaloo back and forth, a lot of reactions globally as regards why did the U.S. pull out of this climate change agreement. Is that in any way affecting the conversations in Poland now?
Absolutely not. The Paris Agreement is operated at three different levels, the regional level, the national level, and the subnational level. As a matter of fact, this morning I was at an event where the issue was the U.S. said that we are still in. I collected a sticker here that said we are still in. Because what happened when at the national level, the U.S. indicated they were not interested, the subnational moved up to take up the position. So nothing has changed. The negotiations are going on. The ambitious plans for reduction of emissions is going on. As a matter of fact, you need to understand that policies that are made on national level are actually implemented at subnational levels. So the U.S. officially might look like they are not on, but officially they are actually on. So it doesn't change anything. The negotiations are going well. They have met their quota in what they need to do, the contributions, everything. So that's not an issue anymore.
Dr. Polo, this conference goes on until Friday. Could you just tell us the major highlights left till the end of the conference that concerns us as Nigerians?
Okay, good. The major highlights that we are talking about remains the same thing that we came here with. Where are we? We are outlining where are we and where do we want to be and how do we get there? In the last week, we had several side events, like I told you earlier, but we are going into this new week now with a new set of side events. The FCT is going to come in and look at Abuja and said, this is where we are. And then this is where we need to be. These are the things we need to do to be able to key into this emission reduction target. And then these are the ways we need to do them. The event on Tuesday that's going to highlight NISIL, which is involved in climate smart agriculture, is going to be key to what we're going to discuss here. Because agriculture is the mainstay of our economy, and the government is encouraging people to get involved in agriculture. Funny enough, the AFOLU, agriculture, forest, and land use, contributes highest to emission reduction. People don't know that. So we need to look at the way we engage in agriculture. While we are trying to increase our food security, we also need to be careful about what we do to the environment. So this is going to be a very key issue to be discussed on Tuesday. And then on Thursday, we are going to discuss an issue that has to do with back to the oil and gas industry, how the oil and gas industry is going to key into this to be able to reduce gas flaring in the process of exploring oil. Then they're also going to look at how they are going to divest their investments into renewables. That is a huge area. Then back to what you said about awareness, we also need to talk about how we are going to do with energy management, how people need to manage their energy in their homes, how people need to manage energy in their workplaces, and how energy needs to be managed in the operations of the industries and commerce. So it's a huge thing. We have a very busy week ahead of us, and I hope you can follow us day by day so that you can understand what we do on a daily basis.
Is there any particular emphasis being placed on the fact that vehicle emissions all over the world is now being reduced by people moving to electric cars? Is that being brought home to us?
Yes. As a matter of fact, at the NNPC presentation, we were all quite surprised to hear that that is part of the plan to integrate electric vehicles in their long-term plan. I never knew that was there, but when they did the presentation, they were clear on that we need to join the world in that direction, because most of the developing countries have set targets at which they want to go 50, 75, or 100% electric vehicles. And Nigeria can't just sit behind and watch that happen. Again, the theme of COP24 is changing together. So the idea is that whatever is happening will have happen in an inclusive manner.
Dr. Abolo, did NNPC give any timeline regarding that? Because I'm smiling because I'm thinking of our power sector here.
Yes, they gave some timelines. I'm not exactly sure about the exact timelines, but I remember that I had 2030 and I also had 2050. I cannot place which of the targets belong to any of these dates, but the year 2030 and the year 2050 we are very prominent in their timelines.
Okay, Dr. Abolo, before we let you go, the part of the pro-ecological dimension of a conference includes the promotion of public and low-emission transport. You talked about a common use of reusable materials, waste sorting and compensation for unavoidable greenhouse gas emissions by afforestation of approximately 700 hectares of the country's area after the conference. Now, these are tasks that need to be met. In your thinking, you've said already that Nigeria is working towards this. What would you say to the Nigerian people, and indeed globally, to anyone who is listening right now as regards the environment, if all of this needs to be taken care of? Low emission transport, common use of reusable materials, waste sorting, compensation for unavoidable greenhouse emissions by afforestation of approximately 700 hectares of the country's area after the conference.
Yes, what I'll say to anyone listening and to the rest of the country is that, one, climate change is real. Two, there's a global action on combating climate change. Three, everyone needs to be involved because it affects everybody. Four, people need to make efforts to know about climate change. I understand that there's need to create awareness, but when people need to find information, they make efforts to go look for it. So they need to make this a priority in their information search. People need to really find out what global warming is talking about, what climate change is talking about. It's only when we know can we cooperate with what is happening. So that's my word for the average Nigerian. That's my word for the CEO out there. That's my word for the private sector. As a matter of fact, I encourage more private sector participation in this. Government cannot do it alone. Civil society cannot do it alone. We need the engagement of private sector in this. And I'm standing right behind the Nigerian pavilion, like I said earlier. This is the first time Nigeria is having a pavilion. It's a big thing in 24 years of the COPs. And we have a sense of identity now at the COP. People want to associate with Nigeria. People want to come to our pavilion to see what is happening. It's unbelievable, the kind of traffic that we have coming in here. We have events, the hall is full, and people are asking questions. People are actually interested in Nigeria. The saying is that if Nigeria can do it, Africa can do it. So it's a big task for us Nigerians. We need to make sure that we do it so that we can take the leadership in climate change for Africa.
Thank you very much, Dr. Paul Abolo, an environmental strategist who joined us from Katowice in Poland. We hope to hear more from you as the conference goes on. Thank you. Sunrise will be back in a moment. Please join us again.